Got the feeling.
Yeah.
You got to know it.
Daddy wants you to go to sleep, see?
You got to be done going through these things. The same to blue. That's why nobody knows I've been through.
You all by yourself down here? Give me a glass of water.
Sorry, where you going, John?
Oh, you here?
Sorry, this is reserved.
How long are you doing?
About 10 minutes, 15 minutes.
I think the most difficult time my father had to face was the divorce that he went through. I think that was just the most traumatic thing and the hardest thing that he had to deal with, because he really loved my mom.
I mean, what could be any tougher than that? You know, he had all of us, but he didn't have his marriage. And when you have to separate the mama from the siblings, and we all can't be together, you understand? That takes something out of you, you know, and I believe if he had a chance to do it all over again, I guess we all would no doubt do it different than we had done it before, you know.
At first, I couldn't stand him. He would call to the house to talk. I wouldn't talk to him. I would give the phone to my oldest daughter. You talk to your daddy. I don't want to talk to him. So finally, I don't know what happened. You know, we got to be very good friends, you know. We communicate together. I guess we got that bind together. We'll always have that, you know.
I have a lot of love for her as a friend, not as a lover, as a friend. I have a lot of love for her. Well, she had my children. And I would break up, you know, there's something between me and her, which I don't talk about, but we got to be good friends, and I always look out for her.
Life isn't always, you know, a laugh, you know, it can be serious, and there's hard times and there's good times, and being a deep thinker like John is, I think anybody like that would have a certain kind of aloneness inside, you know. That's, and blues is like a salve for that, you know. When I didn't have a place to go and I didn't have any money and I was down on my luck and broke and I'd go by to see John Lee. I wouldn't tell him that I had no place to go and that I was broke, but he just knew. And he'd say, "Oh, well, why don't you stay here and go in the kitchen, fix yourself something to eat?" And that's real typical of John, his big heart that he has.
I got just about everything I want in life: love, success, money, cars, homes. I got all that. But one thing I never get enough of, love from people. I never get enough of people loving me and I loving people. You can't get too much of that.
I don't think he looks back. I don't think he has any regrets about how he did it. I think he, you know, he'll always say if he had to go today, he would not have any regrets as he looked back. And I think each and every one of us would like to live our lives like that, to be able to say, when it's my time, I can say I don't have any regrets, that I've done all the things that I want to do.
I won't be here always. I don't think I will. My music will be here forever and forever and forever. When I'm gone, my music will be here. ringing in the people's ears, in their homes, in their cars that we played. That's John Lee Hooker's voice. It's still me, but it's not me in flesh and blood. My memories will forever be here for generations and generations to come. It will carry on my music. When I first started traveling, I lived home when I was young. When I first started traveling,
hey, thank you for all the good times.
Oh yeah, I'm gonna keep on doing as long as I can.
Hey, appreciate it, man. Thanks.
Okay.
Shoot you right down. Yeah, right out of your feet. Take it home with me. I'm put you in my arms.
I love to see you walk. Wow,
okay.
He's not touring like he used to. In my time of working with John and over this couple decades, we'd change the touring to fit what worked for him. But he still likes to play, and I think playing is really important for him. He gets in front of an audience, he gets that feedback, and everybody, and maybe in many cases, artists more than everybody else, have insecurity and appreciate that feedback and that response from an audience, especially when you're older and you're not doing a regular job every day. He goes out there and he knows that he's still vital and he gets a tremendous response.
She walked and walked and talked and talked and whispered in the air.
People are going to remember John Lee as probably the king of the boogie, you know, I think.
You're going to do the boogie, you'll dance all over the place, I don't care.
It's getting up and shaking your tail. It's a groove. It's dancing. It's a dancing thing. It's feel-good music. And, he does it. It's his trademark at the end of the shows. He gets people up, you know. It's a thing where, like, you know, it's shaking the bad, you know, out of your system. It's getting up. It's at the end of the show. You feel good now. It's like therapy.
Thank you.
Janis Joplin.
Thank you. Well, pardon me. The Unitarian. I can't hear. Yeah, yeah.
A lot of people, you know, they say to me, how old is John Lee Hooker? I'm not even going to ask that question. Oh, but I tell you, there's many guys, you know, many years younger that can't do what John Lee does. So it don't matter.
Put it in, Fisher. Baby.
That discovered him, and there were many people that were giving him, you know, the great acknowledgement that he deserved. But John Lee Hooker was always John Lee Hooker. You know, there was no change in John. You know, maybe he has a couple more cars, but you know, he can only drive one Cadillac at a time. But he was, you know, John was never a guy that, you know, needed to flaunt anything or prove anything.